On behalf of Rosa Luxemburg Foundation and also on behalf of Die Linke, I welcome you to our public debate on the question which are the uniting elements of the European left. I think that is really a crucial question, and I appreciate your discipline being here and to discuss with us this really very important question about the elements uniting the European left. Caused by the victory of Syriza in Greece and the brutal rejection of any modification of the austerity policies by European institutions, a broad and intense debate about European left-wing policy has been developed. There are different approaches and initiatives, in particular the so-called Plan B, launched by Jean-Luc Mélenchon in September last year at the Fête de l'Humanité, caused a broad and controversial discussion. This Plan B was signed by prominent left-wing politicians like Zoe Konstantopoulos. Zoe is here to discuss with us. Very welcome. And there are and now we have other initiatives, for example, the initiative Democracy in Europe Movement 2025 by Yanis Varoufakis, and also the Party of the European Left published an action plan against austerity and the leadership of the financial markets, elements of which are demands of restructuring the debt, getting out of austerity, freeing up resources for public investment and transforming the European Economic and Monetary Union. Plan B very often is equated with leaving the European monetary system, in particular the euro. No doubt, the euro is an important issue. In my opinion, however, Plan B can't be reduced to the question euro yes or no. Plan B means, in my opinion, opposing current European policies, that is to say, anti-democratic austerity policies, which cause enormous social problems and are economically counterproductive. The necessity of Plan B was justified with the defeat of the Greek government, and it makes reference also to a so-called Plan A. Plan A, with the intention to reform radically the European Union. And in the case that such a radical reform of the European Union is not possible, and that is obviously the case, a Plan B is needed. Now even a so-called Plan C is discussed, referring to DiEM25, and also to the demand of a social union citizenship promoted, for example, by Katja Kipping. These three plans are also mentioned in the questions sent out in order to prepare our conference. And it was asked, how could left forces divided by different attitudes towards the European Union act together? As I mentioned before, there are different approaches and initiatives, and there is a debate on left-wing European policy. And I think that's really very positive. On the other hand, and that is a negative aspect, there are also high risk of dividing the European left, despite the intention to unify and to strengthen the left in Europe. This concerns especially Plan B and the question of the European monetary system. Therefore, the question, what is uniting us, is so important. The fact that there is a plurality of positions, in my opinion, is not a disadvantage. It's an advantage. But nothing has to be excluded concerning the debate and the discussion. We need that broad discussion in order to identify the elements which could be a basis for a broad and strong European movement of the left. This is the intention of our debate tonight. concerning the debate, it was also asked in the preparatory documents, how can we ensure that these diverse initiatives do not merely develop into a European activist jet set, producing a bubble of an exciting debate, but having little impact on real power relations? That was the question within the documents. I think that's really a challenge and really a very important question. But nevertheless, there is no doubt that we need an intense discussion in order to identify joint programmatic elements. Despite the different opinions and positions presented also here in the conference, there are a lot of common political issues, a lot of common political elements regarding, for example, the necessary radical change of the role of the European Central Bank, the regulation of the financial markets, the need for a different, really different, fiscal and economic policy, and so on. And I would like to remind the discussion about industrial policy, supported also by the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation. I think it's very interesting concerning also investment programs on the European level. There is, however, one point I'd like to stress in particular. In my opinion, the question of labor and of trade unions is often neglected in our discussion. Yes, there was a workshop today dedicated to these questions, but in general, there is less attention to those very important questions. Because I'm convinced that without reference to the culture of labor, without reference to the unions, we can't develop a strong left-wing movement in Europe. Of course, this is a very difficult question. I know it's quite difficult, the relationship with the unions, in particular on European level. We don't have a real trade union movement on European level. The existing European organizations of trade unions, confederation and federation as well, are rather institutions than movements. On the other hand, we have some trade union initiatives. We have networks of left-wing trade unionists like TUNE, formerly known as Forum Social Europe. No, changed the name in TUNE, Trade Union Network Europe. We talked yesterday also about Alta Summit. And I would like to remember also some cross-border struggles by trade unions, for example, the struggle against the Bolkenstein Directive, or the strikes of the dockers, or also the initiatives by trade unions, especially in the transport sector. And now, looking at France, we can see that the protests and the strikes against a false labor legislation is now going beyond the normal protest, is now transforming in a social movement against liberal policy in general. I think these are really encouraging developments, and they, in my opinion, I think in our opinion, deserve our support and our full solidarity. I will end my welcome address here because there are some initiatives in order to express solidarity with France, with workers, and also the social movement of the youth Nuit Debout in France, and therefore I will end here, and I'm looking forward to a very interesting and fruitful discussion. Thank you very much.
Welcome to you, welcome to this warm Saturday night evening, and it's great that you're all here. The room is full, although you could be outside and drink a beer. I think that speaks to the significance of the matter we will discuss tonight. Plan A, B, C, what is uniting us? The events last July in Europe, they're often read as just events in Greece, and the limited space of maneuver for left emancipatory forces in Europe have forced us, and Heinz was saying, talking about that, have forced us to rethink previous ideas about our past to political, social, and economic change. However, I think we should also keep in mind that it was not only the coercion, which forced us to rethink our ideas, but it was also a moment of a highly politicized Europe, and we were a part of this highly politicized Europe. Many left forces in Europe restarted to substantially develop out of this moment new plans and strategies for different Europe, and Heinz mentioned them. Plan A, to refound Europe anew. Plan B, to leave the monetary union, respectively, to not subjugate one's economies under its rules of austerity and deficit rules. A plan C, to develop an economy of solidarity from below. Initiatives that don't call themselves plans, something there are many underway. All these initiatives and all the differences in plans, they share the objective to concentrate forces on the European level and to break with crucial, very different, but crucial European rules. But of course, they have very different starting points and means. In the heat of the controversy in fall and winter, these initiatives or plans, in our view, allowed for new quality of left debates on the future frame and conditions of a different Europe. And especially since they were all discussed with a real feeling of urgency, I think, and that it mattered that we have a plan and that we have an initiative.
Yeah, as Corinna said, the need to concentrate the forces at the European level is obviously seen as urgent for many, many people on different initiatives. The effort, however, would be wasted if in the end we have numerous initiatives competing with each other and do not achieve a critical mass and fizzle out without having any effect. However, there's much discussion about the reasons for the crisis, both of the European Union and the left in Europe. There's a lot of talk about what is to be done, what needs to be changed concerning a different currency system, concerning reforming and democratizing European institutions, about handling the debt, etc., etc., etc. But it is really rare the question asked, who the hell will do it and how? There are hardly any discussions on the political form of organizing and the process of constructing connective practices to become more and build majorities. So there's a real danger of becoming an activist jet set, like Heinz already said, without touching the real relations of force. There's a real danger that our different initiatives lack a foundation on the ground. So how do we become more instead of fragmenting into different initiatives? But since the short summer of migration is a long winter of reaction, if you want to speak in this way, giving authoritarian answers to the hope of refugees and a stimulus program for the far right, things have become far more complex, even more complex than haven't been before. More complex than plan A, B, C, or whatever. Now we experience what happens in France, which is a real sign of hope again, connecting to the struggles of 2011, this time even with unions involved. But this is another thing coming together with struggles against austerity, against TTIP, against the debt regime, and struggles against the far-right racism and the right of refugees. These struggles are not easy to connect in real life. In theory, it's quite easy, but in real life, to connect them, it's really not easy with limited resources we have. So the question is, in face of our differences, what could be a connective perspective or even practice to build something in common? And maybe we could start with a clear example of what's happening with France. We tried to organize it in a different way, firstly, but we have to say that Lucia Kotronaku from Diktio in Greece was not able to come, so we changed rapidly what you see here above, and we will start with Nicolas Galepidis from Solidaire in France, and he will talk about a bit of the situation there, of the new forms of, Kinsey-Emmel-like movement, and the strikes and mobilizations from unions and their relations to one another, and what that has to do with the European Union. Please.
Hello to you all. Thanks again for organizing this conference. So I guess we know everybody more or less each other because we are seeing each other since 2 days. So three things. I was not very prepared to do that because as a unionist in France, my union has signed something that is called the Charte of Amiens, La Charte d'Amiens, that has been written in 1906 and which is saying shortly that unions do not mess with politics. I say it quickly, okay. But anyway, it's absolutely impossible in our world not to mess with politics, even if you are in a union and if you want to apply those things, okay? In France, there is no such thing as an official subsidiarization of MEPs like you can find in Great Britain, for instance. I won't elaborate, but it's a peculiar thing. So it may explain why union people do not share many, many political tribunes, okay? So I just wanted to make my point, but whatever, I am here, and there is no further problem. And one more time, it would be not very responsible not to have it say when you have something like Plan B, because in France there has been many debates, okay, but Plan A will remain shortly in Europe, and we try to work this with the institution, and Plan B we split, and it would be impossible for a union not to have its say, not to have its a word or an opinion on this kind of thing, because obviously Frexit, how would we call it, okay, if France was to go out of Europe, would have dire effects, enormous effects on the collectivity, on people, on workers, etc., etc. So we are supposed to have our say, and we expressed ourselves on the subject. Then all the questions that have been asked, and it's a big subject, and it's very interesting to treat them in the light of what happens in France now, okay? We have a new situation, I should say. I said this afternoon that 2 months ago, nobody could guess what would happen today. Nobody could guess that there would be some kind of a momentum, beginning by a petition, followed by a big union movement, then a big social movement. It's maybe a first in the existence of big demonstrations in France, but when you have front of a demonstration, usually you have the big unions close together, okay, linked together. Then in all the demonstrations we have on the labor law, before this first rank, you have a big rank of everybody, of young people, old people, people that may not have their place in a union, may not have their place in a political party, but that are together in the opposition, in the struggle for this law. So it's a very important fact, because this is to all those people that we should think when we address, when we speak of a Plan B, a Plan C, scenarios, etc., etc., because it's a real subject to convince those people. For instance, on the Place de la République, the Nuit Debout process in which my union has been involved, because we are facilitating the thing, okay? I never spoke on Nuit Debout, I never spoke in front of the General Assembly, but anyway, we are declaring the demonstration every night at the police, we are lending stuff, sound system, etc., etc. We are facilitating the process. We are surveying also, because in the beginning of Nuit Debout, you had far-right movements, confusionists that were lurking on the place. So the idea was to evacuate those people, and to allow all the people that are sitting every night on Place de la République to build their own conscience, because it's a cruel thing to say, but there is a very poor political culture on this place. You have people that are rather with students, higher studies, etc. They are working maybe 6, 10, 8 years in studies, and they discover that there is a labor law that is going to destroy all the possibilities they have to have a situation, a work, etc. That is a promising precariousness. So. The main idea is to convince all those people, okay? And when we speak of, when we have debates that may be very technical, economic and political debates on plan A, plan B, die, E, M, etc., etc., we must never forget to who we speak. And this is a generation. They are rather young, and between 23, 30 years maybe, and they are very curious, okay? It's incredible to see those people sitting for hours under the rain. It's raining, okay, and they sit, it's wet, and they do that, and okay, and no, and they vote all night long. And everybody has its say, they speak 3 minutes, etc., etc., they vote, they prepare things, etc. So it's important never to lose this focus when we have an expression, a public expression, or when we have proposals as radical, I should say, as plan A, plan B. That are necessary, okay, there is no subject. On the last part, I'd say that we, on the union part, okay, we have weaknesses, okay, many, many weaknesses, threats, etc. We see that the labor law is attacking also. It's a third law, okay. In France, there have been two laws before, Rebsamen law and Macron law, that are diminishing the union's power, okay. I won't elaborate, but it's a fact. The last one is also taking care of our strength, okay? Maybe there are less than 10% of affiliates in France, in the French unions. But anyway, we have the capacities to, as you can see every day, to blockade the country, to have a real subject and to have real means of action. And we must not lose this kind of thing. We had a debate this afternoon on the state of the unions in Europe, and it was not terrible. So to finish, the opportunities we have with the unions, we have a real army, okay? We have several hundred thousand of people that can go in the street, that can fight, that can have ideas, we can propose things, but it will always be, it must always be in the common sense, okay? I am in a union that is very strong in the public sector, and one of the main arguments is to say that we must change the sides of the table, okay? It's not about how do we get competition, how do we get profit, it's about how do we get welfare for everyone. It's the first thing a union that is working in the public service is supposed to think. So in this kind of idea, in this scope of idea, we must say that we have, if we work the good way, if we have the real reforms also, because maybe we can have a reform in the politics, but we should have also a reform in the union's functionment in Europe. And it's a pity that there are not many contributions of unions in the Plan B or many unionists that are invited. Well, but my point is that we have under the hand real possibilities and real armies to make things move, to have a real momentum between workers. And it is possible to prove it. The main European actions against big corporations worked when everybody found itself in Brussels, found itself in the core of the beast, I should say, okay? So it's not about going to Brussels, etc. It's to change the balance of power and not anymore consider the business, the corporations as normal partners, okay? They are not normal partners. I'm sorry to say that today they are our enemies, they became this. And it has been one of the demonstrations of Nuit Debout. We made an official ceremony 2 weeks ago in front of the MEDEF, that is the corporation organization in France, with the decision, and we voted to split relationships between the MEDEF and the collectivity, because the corporations are taking care, are putting their nose in the pension funds, they are putting their nose in the social security, they are putting their nose in unemployment, and we say that they have nothing to do in those matters. Voilà. I won't be more long, but maybe we'll have questions later.
Just a small question, because you raised this topic. We have the very small debate about, well, at the same moment in Belgium, it's a strike against the deregulation of labor. It's directly connected to European level, the same as in France. Is there any connection between the strikes in France and in Belgium right now?
And unfortunately not. This afternoon we had the presence of Felipe van Kersbeek, which is on the CNC and very implied in the strikes in Belgium. And unfortunately, there is no connection. And it might be easy, okay, to make some symbolic blockade in the frontier between Belgium and France, letting only persons go forward and backward, okay, between the countries, but stopping goods and merchandises and the trains. The Thalys, for instance, is a real symbol. In Europe, it's a business train, okay? It would be a good action to block it, once and for all, maybe.
Take it with you. So we get a bit further into the south. Catarina Príncipe is from Bloco de Esquerda in Portugal. And she's supporting, tolerating an anti-austerity government formed by Socialist Party, which is a social democratic party in Portugal. And we always debated, and even in Bloco, about getting out of Euro Plan B or not, which stance we have. And now you're suddenly in a government. How's the situation? What is the room of maneuver for that government? And how is this debate continuing right now in this very slightly different reality you're pushed in?
Hi, good evening to all. I think I want to start by, I don't want to say correcting, because that's not exactly the word, but making some things clearer about what Mario said. It is not a left government, neither our SP, our Socialist Party, is a social democratic party. We define it as social liberal, and we don't define this government as an anti-austerity government. We define it as a government that is trying to stop the harsh impoverishment process of the last 4 years of austerity. And I think this is important to say, because it states the difficulties of what is possible within this framework, and also the limitations and the room of maneuvering. But before going to Portugal, if you allow me, since I have a little time for an intervention, and since this has been, in many senses, I think a question and a conversation that has been coming up this conference, I would like to address it. The question of the plans, and are we in contradiction to one another, and exactly how do we do this? And I have to say from the beginning on, I don't have any simple solutions, because I don't think there are simple solutions, because I think we find ourselves in very probably, at least for me, I'm 30, for my generation, in the most complicated situation, political situation we have found ourselves in. And I think I would like to start by saying that I think in order to understand the European project as such from its beginning, and also to understand the European crisis, we need to understand it always at two levels. So finding solutions to the European crisis is a difficult task, because it must be understood, as I said, at two levels, and these two levels must exist or coexist simultaneously. And these levels are the transnational and the national one. So the creation of the European Union was a tool to establish a transnational economical bloc capable of competing with the United States and China in the world market. And the introduction of a common currency was another step in that direction. However, and this is where the two levels come. However, this bloc was created always, and that was always since the beginning, by competing nation states. So nation states that are in economic competition with one another. The process of European integration created dynamics of core periphery, where the markets in the center produce and export cheap goods through the devaluation of the labor value, like in Germany, very clearly through the compression of wages that's been happening in Germany for so many years, while the periphery markets import those products and at the same time transform themselves into service economies. So the process of European integration for the periphery has very clearly meant the destruction of their productive sectors and getting in exchange for that an easy access to credit to compensate for the loss on value production. So that has always been a dynamic of the European Union. And the way the euro, the common currency, was introduced accentuated these inequalities. As an example, the devaluation of the Deutsche Mark in comparison to all other national currencies allowed, of course, the German elites, the German economical elites, to occupy an even central role in the European economy and accentuated the dependency of the peripheries toward the core countries and economies. However, and that's where always the two levels come, that all national bourgeoisies have profited from the crisis and have profited from the process of European integration, even if they did at different levels. I think there is a different level between how much the German bourgeoisie profited from the crisis and the process of European integration and the Portuguese one. But the Portuguese one has for sure profited more so today after the 4 years of austerity than ever. So in this sense, we can't constrain our analysis as one of purely competition between nation states or nation against nation. As we know today, as before, this remains, still is, more than ever, I think, clearly a class question. So, in this sense, are there no solutions at the national level? Are there no progressive politics at the national level? I've heard people saying this at this conference, and I want to refute it, although complexifying it. So we know that the EU is everything but a democratic structure. On the contrary, it imposes anti-democratic policies and measures to democratically elected governments, so the case of Greece, and so the case of many others, of Portugal, even in the right-wing government, or what is happening today, and I'm coming there now. So at the same time that we know of these tendencies, it is clear today for the left that the left needs to be capable of taking a leap from the national level. And this means learning to navigate between the existing national structures and an overwhelming transnational economical dependency. On the contrary of the belief of the European elites, democracy is not an empty jargon. Democracy is an everyday practice that today is only still reflected at the structural level, at the level of the nation state. So at the same time, it is clear that exclusive national solutions to the crisis will never be sufficient at the long run. We still need to think about what can be done and what can be somehow rescued from those structures that are the sole remains of any sort of democratic experiences. So now I pose another question. How can a small country like Portugal, with an almost fully destroyed productive sector and an over-dependency on credit, be able alone to survive in the world market? I mean, of course, the answer is, like this, we won't. So again, we need to think on the two levels. So if we need to rescue the remains of democratic structures, we need struggles at the level of the nation state. For example, fighting for a functional social state means that there are progressive struggles and that there can be progressive politics at the level of the nation state. But in order to implement these measures, we need to actually in order to implement measures that we find essential to actually overthrow austerity and invert the relation of forces between labor and capital, we need concrete measures like, for example, the restructuring of the debt, repudiating the illegitimate debt, public control of the banking system, nationalization of the strategic sectors of the economy, and eventually taking control of our own currency. And I am not fetishizing national currencies. I know that one currency is not more progressive than the other just because. A currency is only more progressive if it is an instrument to advance the condition of the class in a certain moment. So I'm not fetishizing neither the euro nor a national currency, and I think we need always to talk about this in this sense. So, but the problem is that to apply these measures today, these measures are not possible within the framework to nationalize the strategic sectors of the economy. We can't do it within the framework of the euro, within the framework of the EU, within the framework of the budgetary treaty. So in this sense, national politics and economical sovereignty can be an instrument, not an end in itself, per se, but an instrument, and I hope that the answer to this is not that I'm defending that socialism is possible in one country. We are far from that. I'm just saying what can be an instrument to right now invert politics of austerity in the framework and in the over-dependency, in the particular position that we find ourselves in. And so in that sense, I think that to rescue what is left of some sort of democratic structures and to have some kind of space to apply what we see as fundamental policies to advance the condition of the class may have to be some sort of sovereign instruments. And therefore, I also don't want to fetishize the sovereign instruments, but I think we need to pose them as maybe the ones that we will need. So I know that I've spoken a lot already, as usual, but what is the space for national politics in Portugal today? And Mario posed this question. I want to just tell you what the Portuguese Prime Minister said today. They are, this weekend, they're having their party congress. He stated it publicly today, that against a part of the party that is against this government supported by the left, he said, no, this is very good, because what Bloco and the Communist Party allowed us was to distinguish ourselves from the right. So this is good. And he's exactly right, because the space of maneuvering that we're having, and I'm sorry for the ones who have heard this, but since I'm in a plenary, I want to say this again. I think the space of maneuvering that we're having today has to do with the urgent survival of the European social democracies. They are collapsing everywhere in Europe. PASOK, the PS in France, the SPD in Germany, the PSOE in Spain, and the Portuguese PS even, that after 4 years of the harshest austerity did not even manage to win the elections. So they know that their only possibility of survival is to distinguish themselves from the liberal right and to try to co-opt the left and bring up some of the issues. So I think the space of maneuvering that we are having is precisely a political question. It's the question of survival. So the problem is, we know that they are not willing to go further and to actually confront the European institutions when the limitations of their own program will come into place, because they will smash against a wall, and we also know this. And so again, the two levels, right? Because we are talking about national policies and national politics in a space of maneuver of national politics, but we are always talking about it within a framework of a core-periphery structure, an overwhelming dependency on transnational economies, and of course, on the EU. So just to end, and I'm sorry about this, that I'm not giving proper answers, but I think the left willing to build social majorities needs to keep these dynamics in mind. And our position within the relation of forces that we're living today and the different limits and constraints that different nation states will have and are having today will also determine our space of maneuvering, and they will determine our strategy. And sometimes these strategies may be different, and I don't think we should make it a dogma out of it. I think we will have most probably different strategies at some point, and I think sometimes, due to our constraints and limitations, we will follow different paths. I think that still, if we keep in mind that we have an anti-capitalist agenda, that we want to actually transform profoundly the society that we live in, we will always find common ground for action. So reclaiming the national level as still the only one today where democracy is reflected in structures, while at the same time finding common struggles and developing political networks will be essential not only to give answers to the immediate problems and grievances of the peoples, but also for the capacity of overcoming capitalism, even if that seems as something on the long run. I think the EU, as it is today, is not prompting the unity of the oppressed, but on the contrary, it is prompting the unity of the ones who organize that oppression. So profound transformations will unfortunately not happen in all places at once. They will very, very much likely be contradictory, and I think we need to try to prevent the temptation of trying to predict it all and know that this effect will lead to this effect, to this effect, to this effect. We don't know, and very probably there will be contradictory effects. However, I think we will be more prepared to answer this effects and this contradictory phenomena if we don't downgrade our analysis and simplify it, and if we are capable of building roots where the gaps and the contradictions of capitalism allow us to be stronger. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Katharina and Nicolas. After this very strong contributions from various activities and territories, I think now this is a good moment now to move into the platform's initiatives itself and to reflect on their starting points, their potentials, their dynamics, and the status right now after being formed in the winter. And we also ask both of the initiatives, platforms which will be presented about their political form of organizing, their envisioning, and how they see that in that can touch the real relations of force in the EU. You were just kind of elaborating upon. So we will start. I'm very happy to say that we have Zoe Konstantinopoulou here. Oh, sorry. You all know her. She was the president of the parliament in Greece and part of Syriza, and resigned and left Syriza in all these last events in July. Formed, you were part of the LAE, the left platform, which formed and then formed a new, or there's a new party. I think I don't know the name actually. But you're here as a representative, you're a strong representative of Plan B, Paris. And I'm very interested to hear what you have to say on the starting points of Plan B, the scope and the status and the dynamic it creates. And thank you very much for being here.
Thank you too. And thank you for the invitation. Dear friends, dear comrades, ladies and gentlemen, What's Left in Europe? That's the title of this conference. However, the real questions that lie beneath are what's left in the left in Europe and what's really European in Europe. To answer these questions, we need to be honest. To look for solutions, we need to know the truth and we need to speak the truth. It was conveyed to me that my speeches about what is really happening in Greece ever since last summer have provoked some irritation to those who support the current government. And I must be honest, I was puzzled by this communication, which implies that criticism to what the Tsipras government is doing may be unwelcome in such a situation. However, I decided to do what I always do. Speak the truth, because the left which I know and which myself and many, many, many others all around Europe and around the world have served selflessly is all about the truth, transparency and freedom of speech. It's all about democracy and equality. It is about sincere democratic dialogue, discussing the problems, not hiding them under the carpet. It is inaccurately mentioned in the title of this discussion that Plan B is I quote, a left exit from the monetary union. This is not true. Being one of the co-initiators of the Plan B summit, I have to set the record straight. Indeed, it was in a way set straight by the introduction made. The Plan B initiative emerged as an answer to the coup of last summer and to the TINA doctrine preached by the Tsipras government, which has ever since served as a lame pretext for this government to implement, in the name of the left, the most neoliberal policies ever having been implemented in Greece through the most anti-democratic procedures ever introduced in the Hellenic Parliament. Legislation under a state of permanent emergency, a new taxation tsunami imposing taxes higher than ever before, raising existing taxes and making temporary taxes permanent. These were all the taxes that we would abolish. A complete surrender of the democratic procedure to the creditors with the adoption of an automatic mechanism of cuts and budgetary measures which do not even have to be discussed and voted upon in Parliament. The creation of a monstrous privatization fund through which the privatization of all public property, be it infrastructure, ports, airports, seashores, historical buildings, is envisaged. The selling of over-indebted citizens' loans to international private funds. The surrender of people's homes to banks. The sell-off of Greek banks at a scandalously low price. The signing of an agreement between the EU and Turkey violating all principles of humanitarian law, human rights law, and international law, treating refugees like objects and militarizing a purely humanitarian issue, the evacuation of refugee camps by police forces and a ban on media coverage, the dismantling of all independent authorities which oversee radio, television, the privacy of communications, the ombudsman, etc. Attacks on everyone resisting this regime who is being described by the government as an extremist or belonging to the extreme right, a technique which has been used ever since 2010 to defame protesters against the memoranda and the austerity regime. Police brutalizing and turning against protesters, including almost fatal attacks against former comrades. Adoption of last-minute amendments which shield economic crime and provide for defense of for government officials. These are just some of the laws and tactics deployed by the Tsipras government in Greece in the name of the left. Do these practices have anything to do with the left? Or are they excused under the pretext that there is no alternative? This is a question, and these are questions for everyone to answer. In my view, these are practices which alienate the left from the people, from the society, and from its own soul. It is not enough to say there was a coup by the creditors, including the European institutions, last summer. Indeed, there was a coup. But the coup has led to the installment of a regime carrying out all the creditors' undemocratic dictates, a regime defying popular mandate and violating every day the outcome of the glorious referendum held a year ago on the 5th of July of 2015. A referendum through which the Greek people defied the propaganda, defied the terrorism, defied the monetary blackmail, defied the bank liquidity seizure, and said by a 62% no vote that they reject each and every measure now forced upon them by the creditors and by the Tsipras government. Some say that there's a kind of left which will do everything that the right couldn't pass with respect to neoliberal measures. This is the philosophy behind the admiration of Mr. Tsipras expressed by Angela Merkel, Jeroen Dijsselbloem, and Manuel Valls. The latter, only yesterday, complimented Tsipras for passing a 7,500-page law of extreme neoliberal measures in 2 days. By the way, it was in those 7,500 pages discussed and voted on in 2 days that a scandalous provision providing immunity for government officials participating in offshore companies was hidden. A provision later on taken back by the government who had introduced it and taken back, devoted by the same members of parliament who had voted for it. In my view, it is of no use and it is extremely prejudicial for the left to defend this kind of governance. And to defend it out of solidarity to old comrades is a very misled strategy which will lead to the left losing its credibility among the people and losing its natural allies, the people, the social movements, the societies in motion. These are our allies also when in government. And those who forget who are our allies actually have forgotten what the left is all about. To defend this kind of governance will discredit the left and will discourage social solidarity initiatives all around Europe. This is indeed what happened after the capitulation and betrayal of last summer. It will also lead to the right wing and the social democracy to claim that reality has justified their choices and their policies. And Mr. Tsipras may now be attending the Social Democrats meetings, but it is no project for the left to resurrect social democracy in Europe. The Plan B initiative is precisely aiming to show that turning ourselves to the exact opposite of what we were and implementing everything against which we fought is no alternative for the left in Europe. Claiming what is our own, claiming our future and our dignity, and working on every possible alternative to refute predictable extortions and blackmails by the EU institutions is not just an imperative. It is our democratic and social and political duty. Defying the imposition of illegitimate, illegal, odious, and unsustainable debt is among the proposals tabled by the Plan B initiatives, by the Plan B initiative, because the Plan B is all about defending democracy, restoring popular sovereignty, and using all tools available and creating tools which were not available. And in order to talk about this very specific aspect of the Plan B, I will give you an example. It is not a fairy tale. It is not a horror story. It is a real life 2015-2016 true story. In April 2015, a parliamentary audit committee to perform an audit of the Greek public debt was created under the auspices of the Hellenic Parliament, and I had the honor to convene it as the president of the parliament at that time. On June 17 and 18, 2015, the committee produced and published its preliminary report showing that the Greek debt, the debt used against the Greek population to annihilate democracy and the rights of the people, to be illegal, illegitimate, odious, and unsustainable. This is the report, and it's actually going to become very, very rare. I will tell you why. In the meantime, I have brought copies of it, which you can take outside the room. This report was embraced by prominent figures of the fight for democracy and social justice, like Noam Chomsky, Ken Loach, Kostas Gavras. It was praised by the independent expert of the United Nations on questions of debt and human rights. It was adopted by the Greek National Committee on Human Rights. But it was not used by the Greek government in the so-called negotiations. Not in June, when it was published. Not in July, when the extortion was culminated. Not ever. It was not capitalized by the leadership of the GUE parliamentary group. Ever since September 2015, the committee has been persecuted by the government and the parliament leadership. Its offices were removed. Its works were unilaterally declared terminated by the new president of parliament. Its archives were confiscated. The committee decided to transform itself to an association through a meeting held within the Greek parliament hosted by two delegations of the Greek European members of parliament, by two members of parliament who are no longer members of Syriza, Mrs. Sofia Sakorafa and Mr. Nikos Houdis. The committee decided to continue the struggle for justice for the Greek people in the name of what the left is all about, but also in the name of what truth is all about. In the name of repaying this illegal and unsustainable debt, which the government has not even contested, the Tsipras government has pensions down to an envisaged 384 euros for everyone, and provides for absolutely no perspective for the young and the next generations. We can talk about defeat, but we can talk about defeat when the battle is really fought. We cannot talk about defeat when the battle is undermined from the inside. What I suggest then is that we join our forces, we do join our forces, not to discuss, but to fight the battle, to really fight the battle, and not just to fight the battle, but to lead this battle and to inspire the people all around Europe to resist, to disobey, and to claim what is our own. Thank you very much.
As you mentioned, the irritation of the organizers, that was my email. I just want to say a word. In this conference, we invited all the different tendencies of the really broad left from all of Europe and even from Greece. Very different movements, ones that were very strongly connected to Syriza, others that don't, others that split from Syriza. We invited different parties, like Lai also, they didn't. Couldn't come. And of course we invited Zoe here exactly to have a critical and solidarity debate of what was happening maybe in Greece also. We said maybe we should not talk too much about what was happening there, but about the European situation and how to build common projects in Europe. And we even think that it is necessary sometimes to have different, not only different tendencies, but even different organizations in the left competing with each other, and to keep them in touch, debating critically with one another. But what is the truth is always very contested. We have had very critical debates here about what was happening in Greece with people from Syriza, with ex-people from Syriza, and even within the left. We don't have the same positions, but I think we have a very solidary debate what really went choose. And we have the feeling that choose was much more complex than that. So the irritation is not about censorship of some kind of criticism. That's absolutely not. That's why we invited you. But as we are talking here about connective practices, how to, beyond our differences, we might find some commonalities. I don't know if it's sometimes helpful to throw comrades out of a broader left. And that's not our method of organizing. But of course, our method is not the one we want to predict on others. So I just wanted to tell you why I just wanted to tell you that there is irritation to that you know what's the spectrum where you are going to speak in. What's the German left and the debate in the German left, and what our problems we're trying to address, all the debates around Greece that are also debates inside the German left, for instance. That's everything we wanted to do. It's not an irritation that you should not speak here, but maybe we could also debate of how we should talk to one another. But that maybe is enough, and Corinna will skip to Stefan.
So I'm really happy.
By the way, the new party movement, which was created a month and a half ago, it's called Plevsi Eleftherias, Course to Freedom. I sent you several emails mentioning the name. Thank you.
I'm really happy that we have now Stefan Lehndorf, one of the initiators, or the initiator of the platform Founding Europe Anew, Europa Neu Begründen. This is a very particular platform because it is started from and with a trade unionist approach and kind of trying to reach out and thinking about Europe and how what to do with Europe. Also given the many criticisms trade unions need to hear about, you know, their take on Europe and our wish to find connective practices with trade union social movements and left parties and emancipatory forces. So I'm curious to hear how you present not only the initiative but also the current status and what has been going on with the dynamic, how you work with the platform and what you plan for it and how you connect that to the other initiatives on the way. Thank you very much, Stefan.
Yeah, thank you for the invitation and the opportunity to take part in this interesting conference. I must say that if I'm thinking about the group of people who have supported our initiative over the past few years, they would not agree perfectly on the issues debated here in this conference. The interesting thing is what we've done since 2012, we are a group of, say, academics who are engaged with European issues on the one side, and on the other side, some leading trade union officers in Germany. What we have done since 2012 with our first appeal, Found Europe Anew, Europa Neu Begründen. It's on the website, you can read all that if you don't know it. And what we continued last year with our call, Greece is not a threat, is not a danger, but a chance for Europe, an appeal which was supported by all trade union leaders in Germany. And this year with our new appeal, taking the refugee drama as a moment to call for a fundamental, for a radical change of course of action taken both at German and European levels. if I look what we've done over the past few years, is exactly to focus on those issues which have seemed to us to be the most urgent ones, irrespective of different opinions when it comes to more strategic and long-term questions. And this is, for instance, why I would not like to interfere with this debate, which is absolutely crucial and necessary, the debate about how to assess the Syriza-led government in Greece. I wouldn't do that, given my German background. This is a very important discussion. I'm interested in the different and contrasting opinions which I know from Greece, Greek friends and activists. What I would like to do is to focus on the debate which has been triggered all over Europe by the Greek experience last year on how to overcome the dominance of neoliberalism in Europe. This is the overriding question. And my personal opinion is the basic condition for any plan B in a given country at a national level is to have a proper plan A. So I would like to discuss about the plan A. And I think we are lacking a plan A for Europe as a left. And I do like the culture of debate, which I've experienced since Thursday night here at this conference, the culture of debate, which is such a precious achievement, really, in the left, which is not normal, the culture of debate, even when it becomes controversial, we stick together and looking for, say, the next steps, even though we may not agree on the long-term strategies. When it comes to discussing Plan A, let's imagine just for a moment a situation of a Europe without the European Union and without the euro. In such a Europe without the European Union, there is a left majority in one country, or at least a left-wing government in one country, that tries to open the doors towards blocking further neoliberal approaches and open the doors towards alternative social, economical, ecological development paths for the respective country. What would happen in such a situation? It's obvious. There would be an enormous, brutal pressure against this government from the markets. There would be capital flight, there would be soaring interest rates, a battle against the currency of that country, and a battle against government bonds of that country. And this is not just theoretical, this is exactly what happened in the very early 1980s in France against the first Mitterrand government, which was not so left really, but they tried to divert from that beginning neoliberal mainstream. And they were punished for that, and after 2 years they gave in. So we have this experience, and it has been the only experience in Europe so far until 2015. In no major country in Europe was another attempt to block the neoliberal mainstream since that time. Any attempt to disobey the rules of the international financial market capitalism has to face the blackmail of international financial capital. Some 80 years ago, US President Roosevelt gave a speech when he said, and he said, confronting Organized capital is like confronting the organized mob, which at that time was a synonym for the mafia, organized crime. And he was talking about US capital. Today, and to some extent he succeeded, given, and he knew what he was talking about, given his professional background as a Wall Street banker, Wall Street lawyer. He knew the guys. Today, we are not only facing US capital, or we are not just facing German capital in Germany, we are facing international capital. Things have become much more complicated, which leads me to the EU. In today's Europe, and this Katharina has always spelled that out, in today's Europe, the step-by-step establishment of institutions and treaties in the footsteps of the Maastricht Treaty of the early 1990s have institutionalized and to some extent even constitutionalized the neoliberal basics, such as the small state, deregulation of the labor and product market, and so on. The effect of this institutionalization of neoliberal basics has been that the unavoidable conflict with international financial market capitalism has been politicized in Europe, politicized. So, if there is an individual country or an individual government that looks for alternative pathways, blocking the dominance of neoliberalism in the respective country, is not just and not only confronted with the markets. The confrontation with the markets is, in a way, translated politically and institutionally by the EU and institutions in the footsteps of the Maastricht Treaty. And one must acknowledge that all these institutions, all these treaties, all these rules have been established by governments, All governments agreed on this. All European governments agreed on this. This is why they will be It will be, in principle, necessary and also possible to be changed by governments. And if there is a situation where they could be changed by governments, it will be on the basis or against the background of conflicts which will be sparked by conflicts over concrete issues, such as an end to austerity policy, or the conflict over a proper investment strategy for Europe. Of course, an individual country will not be in a position to change the rules. Not even the German government would be in such a position. There would be lots of other governments sticking to the neoliberal rules and isolating the German government as they did last year when it came about joint solutions of the refugee drama. The German government for the first time for many years was isolated last year, and it would happen again if the German government was the only government in Europe that demands for a change of the rules. So there must be a critical mass of governments calling for such a, well, change or reform of the rules to give a larger leeway, bigger leeway, for individual governments and individual countries to look for alternatives to the neoliberal mainstream. And this includes, such a process includes disobedience, not just civil disobedience, of course, that's the basis of all, government disobedience, enormous pressure from below, ruptures, conflicts. It's not a smooth process. Reform sounds so smooth. No, reform is a battle. The effect would be a reform. The process would be ruptures. So, and the funny thing is, the leeway in the end, the leeway for individual governments such as the Portuguese, or maybe the Spanish government in the future, under such conditions would be bigger as compared to a situation in which these governments or countries were isolated in their struggle against the international financial market capitalism. So, to conclude, our impact at EU level depends very much on our impact at national levels in each of our countries. And I have an utopia. My utopia is a European Union as a counterweight to deregulated financial market capitalism, a counterweight, a political counterweight, institutional counterweight. Irrespective of its institutional form, be it a federal state or an alliance of nation state, I don't care for the time being. This is what I mean by a pro-European critique of the EU in its present situation. Of course, this is not realistic. I know that. But no other solution is realistic. It's not less realistic than any other plan. But the best, as a strategy, the potentially most effective strategy towards what I call a solidarity union, which could replace the competition union we have now. And I think we need such an utopia if we want to confront the right-wing movements in Europe. We need our own utopia of Europe as a counterweight to neoliberalism, and this could be a basis of hope. Gala from Barcelona talked today about the importance of hope from her own city experience in Barcelona. And we need that hope, and such an utopia and a struggle towards such an utopia could be a source of hope. Thanks.
I noticed that here above some people might to respond, but no, please be a bit patient and keep it in mind. And I also know that the presenters prepared a second round, but as I look to the time, we want to like to open to you to pose questions, and maybe when you answer the question, you could put also your second round debates in that. So, please, any questions and comments, but please stick to shorter comments. Not co-referent. So, who has the micro? Micro. Okay, we start. Yeah, thanks.
Yep. Okay, thanks a lot for all these important, very important contributions. I would have two reactions. One to Stefan. So, I understand to some extent your argument, but I mean, the starting point of your argument is that we have the capital markets and they are there forever. They are not there since ever. I mean, we didn't have these capital markets. I mean, it was very much under control and under check, even also, I mean, only 50 years ago. So I don't think that we can take this as a starting point. The starting point is to bring back the capital market under control and capital circulation under control. The same way, if you do not bring an argument about the central bank or having an important public banking sector, then of course what you say is probably right. But of course we have to change that as well. We have to have this in mind for the near future or long future. I mean, that is key. So for those reasons, I cannot really buy your arguments. It's logical if you take that assumption, but we should discuss that as well, of course. My second reaction is for Catarina, a colleague from Portugal. First of all, I appreciated very much your arguments. I can agree 90% of it. I would like, but. No, my point is when you're using this term democratically elected government, I think that is an important and a key question. I want to remind here that the existing European anti-democratic institutions have been put in place by our democratic elected governments, right? They sold out democracy. So for this reason, I think that liberal, we don't have a time to develop here, but liberal democracy or representation has to be put under discussion. The same thing what has been explained for the situation in Greece. Well, everybody said, okay, that government is democratically elected and of course should be listened to. But okay, we have heard today, I mean, a different analysis of what has occurred. So what should we think about this democratically elected government? Shouldn't it raise questions as well about the principle, I mean, the principles of the liberal democracy, that is representation? And then my last point, a last example is that, very short, what has happened in Spain with the 15M movement gave us a very nice clues of what democracy, direct democracy, should look like. And then I put also a question about the party which is today representing, so-called, I mean, that movement. Shouldn't it be the way it's working, representation? Shouldn't it be also a question to a certain point? Thank you.
A woman? Somewhere? And then you. But first, any woman? No. So please.
Maybe I should become a woman.
Okay, this is indeed a very short question. If there is a plan C, which one of you will speak about it? And why not?
That would be Lucia Cotronacu, but she couldn't come.
I'm speaking about solidarity economy from the bottom, which is, you know, those who were sitting together with me in the plenaries and the session is my mania.
There can be no plan without plan C.
Sure. Any plan must include.
Any plan must include plan C. Sure. It's obvious. It's the basis of foundation of any other.
Yeah, thank you very much for the different statements. I'm going to make also a short question. It's about, I think it was Danny Roderick who was proposing a trilemma. It was that currently it's not possible to have at the same time three of sovereignty, democracy, and economic integration. So you can have two or three and you're going to renounce to one of them. That could be one question to consider the real capacity to intervene currently in the situation in Europe. But my question is going to be another one. Isn't it possible that it's not about the economic integration, the globalization, the capacity of European, of corporate multinationals to intervene, that's perhaps the democracy, that in this representative form it's exhausted, it's not working more, that we need to try to develop a different kind of democracy? That's an open question to somebody wants to answer. Thank you.
Maybe one more. Still only man.
I'm sorry. I would be very interested, and I thank everybody, to hear Zoe's evaluation of the utopia of
Stefan.
Okay, the last one, Thomas.
Stefan, you presented the pressure of the financial markets as if it would function automatically. However, I think that the pressure or the power of financial markets, or let's say relations of dependency or imperialism, is interiorized in any country only to the extent dependent on the internal relations of forces. And when we talk more concretely, you also said that the French government in the beginning of the 80s was not so left. It was a decision not to take control of the external economic relations at some point. and the government could have acted differently, as the Greek Syriza government could have acted differently. It was a decision, a strategy to follow this line. And so I don't agree when you say that there is no other option under the current circumstances of globalization and the pressure of the financial markets. And maybe I'll leave it at this point. A question for Zoe, why did you found a new party recently? I mean, there are a number of left parties critical of Syriza already on the left. They did not fare well in the last elections. Will this not just lead to a further fragmentation of the left? So what is the point to have one more party?
Okay, thanks. We may start with Katerina and then continue with Zoe and the others.
Okay, so if we're having another round, because I'm still on the question of the two levels, I actually wanted to say something on migration and the question of the far right that hasn't been touched in this panel. I thought it would be, but maybe I leave it for her. Sorry, it's a wasp. maybe I'll leave it for the last intervention. That's what I also had prepared. So I just very quickly, yes, of course, you are right. I didn't get your name, I'm sorry. What? Franco. Of course, you are right. A lot of the governments that have applied harshest austerities have been democratically elected. I agree with you. But I was talking about democracy at another level. I was talking about democracy, even if we're talking about the democracy that crystallizes itself, or the relation of forces that crystallizes itself into structures of the state. This is the type of democracy that I was talking about. So what I mean with that is when we have struggles for labor, for stopping the liberalization of the labor market, where do those struggles find their reflection today? I'm not saying they can't find it at transnational structures or levels one day, but if we have struggles for labor laws, and if we manage to shift a little bit the relation of forces, that crystallization of forces will be present at the level of the nation state. The same thing if we're talking about education or health. So if we're struggling for public free education, these struggles are struggles about democracy, because a functioning social state and good labor laws are what allow us to participate coming from different class positions, coming from different ascendancies, descendancies, to participate in a more equalized way in life. And so this is the type of democracy that I was talking about. Although I agree with you that this democratic, and of course, this is not, one thing is not counterposing the other. Of course, this governments were elected democratically, but that doesn't mean that we should stop the discussion on democracy, on representative elected. I think that's exactly what you were saying, and what I was trying to say in my intervention was that when I'm talking about democracy, I'm talking about, for example, of a functioning social state, which I think is a fundamental base for today, for a lively, participated form of democracy. So not just when you cast the vote, but exactly because democracy is about daily practices and about what allows us. Okay, maybe I misunderstood your question. Just one thing on Plan C. I think there is no other plan without Plan C. So what do I mean by, I think Stefan will probably say something similar. What do I mean by this? I don't think there are, in my perspective of how we build left politics, there are no other whatever possible plans without an implementation at the roots, without an implementation at the level of the movements, without an implementation of networks of solidarity, of networks that at some moments are able to even counterpose what the state is doing. And I think Haris today was talking in our meeting about the first and the second Syriza. So I wanted just to say something about the first Syriza. And I think the first Syriza taught us a very important lesson because it brought together things that we on the left tendentially think as different traditions. So either you have the tradition of the ones who organize in political power, parties that dispute state power, or you have traditionally the tradition that thinks that building movements of self-determination, of self-management, that are in ways building parallel structures to the structure of the state when the state is not functioning. Those were two different traditions on the left. And I think what the structures of solidarity have taught us was that these two traditions that seemed incompatible and on the left clearly always struggling against one another are compatible in moments when the political fight and the political level is understands that there is not one without the other. There's no majority, sustained majorities, without grassroots organization, experiences of self-determination, markets without middlemen, parallel structures of solidarity. There is not one without the other. There can be, but then they're not sustainable. And so I don't think there can be neither a plan B that is successful, or a plan A or a plan X that is successful, without what here was called the plan C. That is the basis of sustaining any sort of left policy, in my opinion.
Thank you. I think what's very interesting and important in the debate and also in the questions coming up is this perpetual concern about real democracy. And to me, real democracy is there in representative democracy as well as in direct democratic procedures. It's not really what we have been experiencing in Greece and in Europe. It's not really democratic institutions having been exhausted. Rather, I would say it's been the persons incarnating the institutions who have made specific choices, sometimes very, very undemocratic choices. It is in the same institutional framework that the current parliament is only operating under the extreme emergency rule, voting hundreds of pages in a few hours. It's being protected by hundreds of policemen who react to protesters as enemies. It has buried every kind of investigation on the truth about the memoranda or the claims of Greece against Germany stemming from the Second World War, the famous German reparations issue. It has refused to hear from social movements and social actors in several instances. And it was in the same institutional framework that the parliament of the previous period held its doors open to society, open to protesters who would come into parliament and table their petitions, open to migrants and migrant communities who were hosted in special parliament TV broadcasting emissions. It was the same institutional framework which allowed to have the Truth Committee on Public Debt, which allowed to have several direct democracy procedures having the citizens within the plenary, etc. What I mean is, I don't think it's a very accurate criticism to say that representative democracy is showing its limits. I would say that it's the people who incarnate the institutions who have shown their limits and who have also shown what they're all about. In my view, the left and any plan involving the left cannot go anywhere further without having an intrinsic relationship with the social movements and with the society. And the formation, let me answer the question by our friend at the back, the initiative to form a new party and movement, because Course to Freedom is a party and a movement at the same time, does not aim to divide. It actually aims to multiply forces to the goal of creating a very, very wide front of forces which will counter and which will bring down this undemocratic regime represented by all the memoranda forces, including the current government. The left, in my view, cannot only talk about itself, and it cannot put itself higher in the hierarchy, higher from society. In my perspective, and I guess this is the rationale behind forming this new movement and party, Course to Freedom, is that it is of the essence at this point to strengthen the society, to help the people rise up, to encourage social movements to work together with social movements and with the society, and it's through this kind of action that the left itself will be reinforced. It won't be vice versa. It won't be by introspecting and only thinking about re-establishing its forces that it will rebond with the society. So this is the rationale behind this initiative, and it's a rationale which has been actually very welcome by the Greek society. And also what is being documented is that a lot of people who had been totally discouraged, a lot of people who had been totally disillusioned, a lot of people who did not vote in the September elections, are back on their feet and they're getting repoliticized and they're reclaiming what we all should claim. So this is yet an object to fight for. I'm also obliged to make a reference to what was mentioned about democratically elected governments. Well, and I think it's good to put this on the record. The September elections, as you know or may not know, were snap elections which were provoked by Tsipras alone. Syriza as a party never decided to have elections. Actually, on the 30th, I'm happy that the Syriza former secretary is there nodding. On the 30th of July, the Syriza Central Committee decided the exact opposite, that there would not be elections before a Syriza Congress would be held. And Tsipras promised his party, of which I was a member as well, he promised that there would be a Congress. Of course, there is historic responsibility to those who bought this promise. There is historic responsibility to those who didn't take any decision on the memoranda and gave a carte blanche to Tsipras to move on with this neoliberal project. But the truth is that the elections of September were not decided by Syriza. They were snap elections. As president of parliament, which is the third official in state after the prime minister and after the president of the republic, I learned about the elections by the media. It was subsequently revealed that the president of the republic and the prime minister Tsipras had been discussing and had agreed on the elections with the creditors. This was part of the information given to the public by the European Commission representative at the end of August. These were unconstitutional elections which led to an unprecedented percentage of abstention. There was 48.5% of abstention, and there was another 3.1% of null and invalid votes. And in all, the whole valid votes that led to the formation of the current parliament are much less than 50% of the voters. Mr. Tsipras, under the label of Syriza, but with almost half the members of the Central Committee having resigned, and members of the parliament having resigned, and a lot of party members having resigned, still running the elections under the label of Syriza. To me, this is not Syriza 2, this is Syriza Sham. But he took 36%, which is 18%. This is not a democratic legitimation to abolish the 62% no vote of the referendum. And what is really happening in Greece right now is a very, very undemocratic implementation of the totalitarian dictates on the part of the creditors. I have very often been accused of being a utopianist. I do believe that the only realism is idealism. I do believe that we were right, we were not wrong, back in 2001, saying that another world is possible. And I'm still willing to fight to have this world become our true, real world. Thanks.
I just want to answer quickly to the questions of Franco and Thomas. Of course, to bring capital markets under control is a core issue, maybe even the core issue of the idea of European Union and the institutions and rules of the European Union as a counterweight to international financial market capitalism. Absolutely obvious. It's a crucial element, it's a core element. But this brings me to the question of Thomas. I absolutely agree. It's always a question of the balance of power. Beginning at the national level. This is why I've talked about the critical mass of countries, of European countries, in a position to demand, a curtailing of the markets. You know, that's what it's all about. We need a critical mass, and the critical mass depends on the balance of power in the respective countries. So far, we are far away from that situation. So we're discussing to some extent, we're having a phantom debate, because we're debating problems we don't have already, because we don't have them yet. We will have them at a certain point when we've got further towards a majority of anti-neoliberal positions in our respective countries. And I would never say there is no option to fight neoliberalism and to curtail neoliberal dominance at the national level. I would never say that. We've had this discussion in particular in the 1990s. It came up, really. It popped up. Today, globalization, nothing is possible at the national level anymore. You remember the old, well, my generation, I'm 69. You all remember that debate at that time. And I fiercely opposed that position. I said, we have the possibility to at least to avoid the worst and to defend the achievements of the past at the national level. And we have to take any opportunity in that direction. But the possibilities don't get bigger, don't improve to do that at a national level. I mean, we can have a long debate about France in the early 1980s. I mean, it was not a clear-cut left-wing government, obviously. It was a social democratic government with a minority, with a junior partner, the Communist Party at that time, that left, I think, after 2 years, left that government after they gave in the pressure of the financial markets and the capital flight of French capital abroad. Capital flight. So, I mean, they could have done more. And the basis, the economic basis of France was not that big, and in particular the institutional basis at that time. A large public banking system, for instance, was a very good precondition for such a move. But it would have needed a rapid radicalization of their approach, and they didn't have the guts, obviously, the Social Democrats at that time. Well, that was the experience, and it's not so far away from what Catarina said about Portugal. I mean, we're not talking about a left-wing government in Portugal. I think she's right, social liberal government, a minority government supported in the parliament by two left-wing parties. And it's, I mean, one has to be very realistic in this respect. Now, if you want to go further at the national level, you have to have the guts to do so. You have to have the guts, the courage to radicalize at a very short time your approach. I give you the exception of Portugal. If Portugal would leave the euro now, just in an emergency situation, what would happen? I mean, the soaring interest rates can be taken for granted. Capital flight, at least from international, from abroad, can be taken for granted. All that can be taken for granted. The economic base of Portugal is better than the one in Greece, but not so brilliant. Not so brilliant, to say the least. So what they would have to do in that situation, they would have to reform their own central bank and allow capital control, of course, allow a direct funding of the state by the central bank, which would come very close to a revolution, very close to a revolution, because they would need a... I mean, I would be enthusiastic about that experience. I would really, I must say, me personally, I would show solidarity in either case, in the case of a struggle within Euro with Portugal, and in the case of Portugal leaving the euro, in either case, I would show and I would really fight for showing solidarity with their attempts. But I think the second option is extremely difficult, extremely risky. It would come, very, well, for instance, direct funding of the state by the central bank. It sounds easy, but the implication is you have to develop your own value-added base, to say it economically, your economic power base in your own country without foreign support, without foreign investment coming into your country, all that. You needed a patriotic bourgeoisie in your country, a patriotic bourgeoisie in your country, unless you nationalize everything, or almost everything. I mean, this is why I'm saying it comes very close to a revolution. And I would be very sympathetic with that approach, but I just want to point at the difficulties and at the risk, and one has to be aware of the risk, one has to spell that out and analyze the whole chain of consequences and say, yes, we want that, and then you have to get the majority in your country for that approach. And yeah. And this is why I think the Ethiopian idea of a renewal of the European Union, renewal, found Europe anew, a renewal of the European Union and its institutions as a counterweight to neoliberal dominance is the most realistic strategy amongst unrealistic left-wing strategies. And for this, as we say in German, for this you need a long breeze and langen Atem. Thanks.
Nicola, the last one. Will you socialize something?
Yes, quickly. So as for the capitalist bourgeoisie, we tried it in 81, like you said, with Mitterrand, and it didn't work, okay? Money flew away. Okay, now, quickly on democracy. President Hollande has been elected in 2012. The labor law was never in its program, okay? So you can do anything you want, you can elect, you can have all the good processes. There was no promise, okay? But there was no, this law didn't exist. So whatever, we are in the street. Two quick things. On violence, okay, the French state, the French words of the prime minister, the French words of the number one of the corporations in France, Pierre Gattaz, are something of warmongers, okay? They declared war on the social movement. They are treating unions like terrorists, they call them terrorists, and it's very fortunate that in France we have a state of emergency law following the attacks on Paris. And I can tell you that they are widely using it, they are making visits to people, to union people, to union guys, to everybody which is known to be in the street and to be organizing the strikes, the demos, etc. They go and visit them, they forbid them to go to the demos, etc. So to our eyes, it's the behavior of someone that is at the end of the line, okay? You cannot, in the Europe of today, have this kind of behavior, okay? A behavior that goes back to years and years in the past, okay? And second thing, I want to thank everyone here because we had a huge feeling of sympathy, of support for what happened in France. And I will go back, and all the messages you can send to all the organizations, to all the relations and to all the contacts you have in France are welcome, because we are in our struggle, okay, and we do not see the size of the support, of the sympathy that our struggle is generating in Europe, okay. So it's a very good thing, and a very big thank you to you all.
This conference is about how do we get to all these problems Stefan was referring to, how we get into a position to really talk about what the next government might do or not do. And this was the last public event after more than 12 hours today of conference. Tomorrow at 10 in the morning we will try to continue to resume and hopefully come to some commonalities and strategies, or maybe just to point out what our differences are and where the open questions. But at the moment, thanks for this very controversial debate. And I hope you have enjoyed.